spring break.
I'm planning a trip to Dubai. So if I go, I'm going to do, I guess, skydiving out there in the palm islands, whatever. And then like the safari jeep rises up in the desert. So that's what I plan to do. But if I do it, I'll bring some footage. Why Dominican? Why'd you guys decide to come to Dominican? Yeah?
It was the cheapest option, and I got a really good scholarship.
Okay. That makes more sense. That way the money's available, that's primary. Anybody else? Okay, so this week we get our 1 minute speeches. Everybody ready?
Yes.
Who's not ready? Everybody coming up here to talk with confidence, or are you coming up here to be nervous? Who's nervous to speak in front of you? Well, I mean, we'll get in as many people as we can today, and then on Thursday, we get in too. I prefer today, so if you're ready to go, just get up. Are you not ready to go?
We're going up as groups.
This one is individual, I believe. Oh, you know, no, I'm sorry. This is group. Yep, this is your group. Yeah.
The peer competition for not to listen to that one, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
So what's that?
Oh, you know, no, this is your other one, too. All right, so we got two things. So what I'll do is break them up. I'll leave one for Thursday. I'll leave one for today. So how about we come up? Who's, all the groups are ready? What they got, need to discuss? Okay, so today we'll do groups. Thursday would be individual. Yes, I see. All right, who wants to go first?
We don't have a full circle.
Who are you missing? Did he say he was coming to class?
I can talk about it.
Okay, go ahead. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, do you have, is there something you want to put up here, or are you good?
Well, we just have the few.
So you could keep them, you said.
I submitted this in campus, but.
Okay.
I did monopoly and altogether we did monopolistic. Bonnie did Monopoly. He chose Standard Oil Company. And basically Monopoly is a single company competitive field where they own all of the resource output and input. But Monopoly is very difficult to get into because only one company is in it. And there's really no room for competitiveness because they basically will buy you out if you try to join, or they will just drop prices enough to where you can't compete. Second would be Monopolistic. That we chose Head & Shoulders, the shampoo. That was a company formed under a parent company. I think the parent company was called Procter & Gamble. So Head & Shoulders is a in Monopolistic, which is a bunch of different competitive firms that all have a similar product with a slight differentiated part to them. So Head & Shoulders specifically focused on anti-dandruff, which separated them from the rest of the competition. This allowed them to succeed in that competitive field. And then for Oligopoly, we chose Toyota. Toyota is currently the number one automobile company. They first started making looms for automobiles, and then grew into making more parts and then parts themselves. Toyota succeeds a lot in Oligopoly because there are four other major companies, and this allows them to not have anyone else try to come up into their field. They kind of buy, kind of like a monopoly, they can buy out that competitiveness. Toyota is best succeeding in an oligopoly because of their type of cars and their work rate and their kind of They're best known for how they do their cars best.
Pure market is where it's like, oh, everybody, there's nobody that affects the market price, so no producer is so big where they can buy everybody out, and no sellers, like, or like, no consumer can like buy everything. It's just all even price. What you see is what you get. So my industry was agriculture. So take it, for example, like the price of eggs or wheat, is what you see is what you get. Like, they'll sell it for a certain price per pound or unit. Another example of this is like the stock markets. People really don't get to decide, it's just how the market is doing. And in terms of easiness to get into, it's really easy. Entry cost is really easy to get into. Entry cost is low. And then if you want to leave the business, you can just leave a little to no cost or whatever cost you had to take to set up the business. So it's real simple and easy for beginners.
All right. Excellent. Thank you, guys. Any questions for them? No? Excellent, right? So this is preparing you for when you guys be out here, right? Last week in class, I hear what your posters. You get a lot of people grilling you, other professors, right? About just kind of knowing the industry, market, knowing about the competitors, stuff like that, right? So then we're gonna slowly build up the confidence, right? You're not gonna come out here and be perfect. That's not what's gonna happen. Slowly build our confidence as we learn more about economics, international trade, and we'll really know by the end of this class, like, we know exactly how all the different mechanisms work. But what you guys did is excellent. You identified the markets, you were in the industry, how competitiveness works within that market, how people buy out each other, things like that. So excellent. Let me think if I got any questions. Toyota. What do you think Toyota is most known for? Just from your personal sort of observation, not even your research. Or anyone else? What's Toyota most known for? Just the number one company.
The Camry.
Yeah, but what are they known for? Like the brand, like when you think of Toyota.
Improvements.
Yeah, the quality. You buy a Toyota, it's going to work for a very, very, very
what's the other brand that people think of that I do get you this type of brand car? Because it'll last, huh? Yes. Right? So both Japanese companies, Toyota and Honda, are known for quality, right? It's not about being the most luxurious car out there, the most stylish car. It's not what they're about, right? What they're about is like their process in engineering the cars on the manufacturing line, getting all the parts together, so quality, right? Everything works. But as we look to even, like, well, that's a Japanese brand, it's a Japanese culture to have that. We can look further and be like, well, Japanese work as a unit, we as Americans are very individualistic and egotistic, care about ourselves and not the group, right? Therefore, it manifests itself in some of the things we do. May not be that great, right? But Japanese, the culture is viewed as one whole beehive unit, right? So all of that translates into how they produce certain products. And the Germans, you think of Germans, you're like, oh, okay, Mercedes-Benz, Audi, BMW. You think of engineering, right? Excellent engineering. Most people think of this over engineering. You need a certain tool to just change your tires. Special tool. But just, you know, keep that in mind. Like, not only do your research, right? Your research and stuff, but give your honest observation, right? You say Procter & Gamble own Head & Shoulders. You know, Procter & Gamble owns mostly all of, not mostly all, but a lot of the stuff you buy for household products, right? And so obviously they own a lot of brands. Okay, who wants to go next?
Materials that other companies need to produce their, to manufacture more unique products. Because they're just the suppliers, they don't have a need for brand identity or differentiation. So oftentimes companies just buy from farms that are close by, that are local, gives them the best deals. Of course, different crops need different parts of the world to buy from, but all of the plants are pretty much the same. It competes with others through. So that's all right. If an entrepreneur wants to get into the agricultural market, all they really need is land and the right area. They might be limited on what type of crop they can produce from their geographic position, but once they get the land and the equipment, they're pretty much on an even playing field compared to other farmers, because land is a limited resource, and companies always need crops. This industry also operates on thin margins, and it's subsidized, so there is an incentive to sell to anybody who needs it, and to always sell. You don't have to compete with others or crush them, monopolize the industry. It's something that everybody can get into. There's, of course, not everyone has the money to enter. Once you do, you can do good in the agriculture industry.
So for I chose the petroleum industry. It's an industry that's pretty hard to get into since it's controlled by large companies. Because it's an industry that
know, sell streetwear shoes. They sell athletic shoes. So they all have similar products for similar usage. So what specific qualities these shoes have, like, separates them from the other brands? Like, for example, if a Nike basketball shoe has more traction, has more traction than, like, saying Adidas basketball shoe.
I did the UPS, no, United States Postal Service, and they deliver mail, obviously. They're like the only one, it's a monopoly basically, that delivers actual physical mail, but then there's like FedEx and UPS for more packages. They're pretty much all over the United States, all 50 states and territories. And then they've just been around the longest in the country. And there probably might be a law or two that says they're not the ones. So that's how they get into that. And they just, control
them. All right. Give them a round of applause, everyone. So how to ease up on nervousness, right? Having to come speak in front of a lot of people, right? Since I teach psychology, right? It's kind of other field I teach in, right? So in essence, when you come to speak in front of people, it's your image of what you think people think about you, right? So the best speakers are people don't think about you. That way you can fixate and focus on organizing your thoughts. It takes a lot of time, definitely not easy. It takes a lot of time. Even some professors are not great speakers. So I would say confidence building is another thing we'll work on as we go through the class. Right, having confidence. Now, how do really good speakers keep their audience and organize their thoughts? Literally, in your head, have about 3 bullet points. Never try to be super duper technical and try to solve every problem or whatever, you know, I ask you to do. Right? In your mind, have 3 takeaways. Right? It's like a TED Talk. Like, hey, today I'm going to talk about blah, blah, blah. Here are my 3 takeaways, right? And now your audience is already interested. Well, okay, so what's the 3, right? Instead of saying, like, hey, I'm going to talk about 1,000 things, and they're awesome. And so focus on, it don't have to be 3, but it could be 1 or 2, right? But focus on that and make it organic, right? Don't make it so constructed in a sense of, you know, when you do your research, it's almost, you speak as if you're, writing a paper, right? Because a lot of times when we write papers, we speak in a phony voice. It's not us, right? This is some voice that might be saying highly intelligent, right? But, and now I'll tell you, this is how it gets started off. When I was, when I was an undergrad, this is how it starts. So it's nothing weird. I mean, it's just how it goes, right? But as you go through education, you learn 3 things. The more you know, the less you know you don't know, right? And that's just the truth. By the time you get your PhD and somebody say, hey, what's 1 plus 1? You go, I don't know. What units are you? You get what I'm saying? 1 plus 1 don't really make sense. You gotta be specific, right? Because we can't answer for everything else. But that's the point, right? Point is to come and be organic, be yourself. Talk about real observations, hey, you know, when I go shop at this place, I always see this, and I kind of notice they do this and stuff like that, right? And then it just makes it easier. So in psychology, you know, I don't know if you guys heard of Sigmund Freud. His colleague was Carl Jung. But Carl Jung argued that we all wear a shadow, right? He said our whole life is we journey through a shadow. We wear a fake face. We wear a fake face for a boyfriend, girlfriend, to mom and dad, co-workers, whatever, right? Only we know who we really are, maybe one or two other people know who we really are. But the point is, like, as we move through life, we want to be more and more authentic. And it makes it easier. It makes it easier. Because when it's inauthentic, you got to think about it. You got to go through your memory. You got to go through your short-term or long-term. A lot of times, short-term memory sucks because even if you prepare for something really quick, your nervousness will make you forget it. So authenticity, goes a long way. Goes a long way. As opposed to trying to be the smartest person. But that's something I have learned too. So here's the rule, right? They say bachelor's degree is to get a job. Literally what it's for, right? They say, master's degree is to teach, right? And PhD is to teach yourself. So it takes you that damn long to figure out like how to just teach yourself. Right? Which is like real research. Research is like stuff you create. Like, I surveyed all the kids in class and they did this and that, and I came up with this data. Here's my conclusions. This happens to be true for these amount of students, right? Hispanic, black, white, whatever. Right? And you go, oh, okay, that's original research. You can still buy this research. So, what it is, it's like as you go through life, you learn how to teach yourself and be more authentic to self. Right? And it helps the confidence. So just think about this stuff like as you go on. You're not gonna get a all be super confident coming up to talk. I mean you talk in front of me because you already know me, but once we get out there, right? And you're like, oh, it's good. Yeah, but what about this? I mean that doesn't make sense. So just keep all that. Who's next? I was gonna say one thing with Nike. Who? You said something about Nike, right? The other thing too about Nike to think is a big one, right? Is when you have these shoe brands sponsor celebrity sponsorship deals, right? So really, you could be like, well, how do we grow? How did Adidas edge out Puma last quarter or something? That's like huge. So they're always going for it. Because if you look in the NBA, the NFL, different brands sponsor that jersey for the season, right? So you say in the NBA, oh yeah, everybody got a Nike jersey, right? No Adidas, no Puma, they got a contract. So you're like, man, that's big money. They're gonna supply all the Nike jerseys, right, for what the year. That's another big one too, just to think about this. Who's next?
Airlines to even get a spot in airplanes.
I'm Natalie.
you could compete with like the other gas stations nearest to you. As for if it's easy to get into or not, it's actually like it depends, because like sourcing gas would be an issue, like sourcing the gasoline itself, and then another issue would be like actually like starting up the gas station, and it would take a lot of money to like invest into it.
I did want a holistic competition. My example is Microsoft Windows. It's running some version of Windows is currently running on 80% of all personal devices. It has very little competitors. It's hard competing with superior cloud software and hardware products because we have competitive pricing, compatible services, and high quality products. Microsoft uses broad differentiation as a strategy for comparative advantage because it has a wide variety of unique products that are accessible and likable to all customers.
Excellent. Any questions? What are some other ways airlines try to make money? Think about it, okay. Right? So we just learned airlines are pretty set. The actual aircraft, right, you're going with Boeing, you're going with Airbus, right? So they're pretty standard, right? So these fixed costs. The fuel is fixed cost too, right? The fuel is gonna be probably uniform all across the board for all airline carriers to purchase. So you're like, man, there's a very small profit margin, right? Very, very thin profit margin. So how do we get there and make money, right? So you said adding extra, what were you saying?
I said that they have memberships, fly miles.
So right, you add membership, benefits, points. The more you fly, the more you'll get a discount on the next flight, right? So that might entice demand to increase people.
They like charge you if you
want to
get like Wi-Fi in the plane, or
yeah, so upgrades. Yeah, upgrades, right? You want to get Wi-Fi, unlimited this. What else? Like what's?
They charge you different based on their age. Like that's why they require you to show ID, so you can't just sell a ticket to someone else with a different pricing per person.
Okay, so price per
are
person.
Are you using this luggage?
Luggage too, right? Southwest lets you think two for free, right? Mm-hmm. That probably entices people, right? Yeah, I'm always gonna have two bags, right? Or I bring a lot when I travel. Versus other carriers, like, no, you gotta pay, right? You got one carry on, that's your bag. The other one is small regional airports, right? So they'll have smaller aircraft and focus on Jackson, Wyoming, Omaha, Nebraska, right? Montana. But that's like things like Alaska Airlines or something like that. So those smaller airlines are like, well, we can't compete with United, American, Southwest, JetBlue. So how do we even make money at this point, right? So they can create. Or they'll do packages for like resort packages. Not only could you buy a plane ticket, but depending on where you're going, you can also look at your 3-day cruise, look at you be able to discount on hotels. They work with the hotels too, right? So they all kind of work together in the same industry. So they can get you discounts on the hotels, get tickets from us, right? So you save money, stuff like that. So just think about all the tie-ins when you're also thinking about your business. Like think of all the tie-ins in the marketplace and how to make money. You know, all the creative ways. Someone had mentioned, who did the farm? Agriculture in the previous group. Somebody mentioned agriculture.
Right? Yeah.
Remember when we were talking about economics, it was like, okay, great. It is subsidized, right?
Yeah.
And then we said limited resources, right? So we said scarcity. So when we're talking about economics, we say, well, scarcity is like there's only X amount of land, right? And available land to produce a certain product, soil, or food, or whatever. So that was a good one, a good tie into economics as well too. I think it for now that I want to ask the group. Maybe I think of something else. Who else? Who's our last group?
Fast food chain restaurants, and how all the restaurants like Popeyes kind of like branched off of like everybody's idea, because it's like a spicy chicken sandwich has always been around, and yeah, the item is new to Popeyes' menu. So as they like had a blow up in that time, all the other like companies like McDonald's, KFC, Burger King decided to hop back on like not an old trend, but like the same thing they had in their menu, and just go on with the spicy chicken sandwich. So, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you guys. That was excellent. Questions? No questions about the spicy chicken sandwich? Actually, Ariane, that was an excellent example. Because it's just one that all of us can simply relate to, you know, all the time, right? When Popeyes did come out and array, right, basically they kind of just used social media to spread out the word, you gotta try Popeyes chicken sandwich. It's actually not that good, you have some time. But yes, everybody else started catching on, right? Even Wingstop has one now. That's a really good example. Think of this for your future entrepreneurs. Warren Buffett says, "What's the? Who knows who Warren Buffett is? Who's Warren?" Yeah. So Warren Buffett is the greatest investor in human history, literally, the greatest ever. But his company is Berkshire Hathaway, and I may have told you guys already, they buy all other companies. So they own Geico, I think they own the majority shares of United Airlines and American Airlines. They own the majority shares of Coca-Cola, for a new single company. So yeah, he's big time. But he says the easiest business, if you want to be an entrepreneur, is to start a farm. Why? Because literally, there is perfect competition, right? Corn is corn, and everybody's going to wheat or beans or rice or something, right? We're always going to need to eat. And all you need is land, right? You just need available land where the soil is right to produce a specific, what we would call commodity, right? So don't let farming get, you know, beyond you. That's simply probably the easiest business to start. Besides, I think like real estate, yes? Thursday, have your business profile ready. Individual. Any questions? Yes.
So that has to do with like the one we picked out?
Yeah, those are like the individual.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, individual.
Yep. We're just kind of fit in the paper.
Yeah, like I said, just come up here and give a 2-minute spiel. What your picture company, what was interesting about it. What you hope to learn. Any questions?